Okay. Start streaming. Come on.
Just make sure whenever you search for a different thing, if nothing pops up.
Yeah. Let's get this working. Okay, I think it's working now. I'm so bad at technology. That was unbelievably frustrating. Sorry for anything anybody saw that shattered the illusion of how cool I normally am. I'm not gonna end this. This one's actually gonna be even better than the other. Okay. Alright, Joe. Yeah, people are in? It helps the fourth time's the charm. That's what I'm seeing. God, I'm so bad at technology, guys. This is why it took 2 years to do this live stream. Okay. Joe. So, as I said before, kind of juxtaposing the piano classical sample with this kind of hip-hop based beatboxing, that's what we thought was really cool about this song. We got a lot of... So, I guess I said this before, but let me say it again because I want to give him a shout-out. We got Kenny Urban, who's this world champion beatboxer, to lay down this stuff. And that kind of mixed with this wandering classical piano thing is what we thought was really cool about this. So we got him professionally recording it on a real mic, and then we also got him to record voice memos of it. Which is this stuff. And I think the iPhone voice memo app just naturally has like a really strong compressor on it, really tight EQ on it. And we thought, okay, let's combine the two. So it feels a little lo-fi, a little hi-fi. So this part was kind of interesting. We thought, how can we combine a lot of stuff together? We have this 808 that's bam, 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 bam. We have this kind of that I'll talk about later what that is. We have the classical piano thing. We have stomps. We have beatboxing. It was kind of a challenge to fit all of this in the sonic headroom that we had. So let me break this down a little bit. On the bottom we have this kick and stomp. Then we have this 808. Which is kind of the bass line here, and we distort it so you could hear a lot of high end, because a lot of times an 808 is just kind of going to be lost if it's all low end. Then above that, we have the beatboxing that I talked about. We have, what's this? I think this is me singing through Harmony Engine. Yeah, that's me going, and then kind of artificially creating chords on top of that, which is a nice little alien electronic feel. We have, this thing is kind of cool. Okay, I found this YouTube video of a young Irish boy doing a vocal lesson, and I ended up cutting it up to kind of create this melody. Serves as the main melody, and then later when it gets bigger, I put a choir effect on it, which basically detunes it, detimes it, basically creates a false vibrato, basically creates a choir out of a single voice. And then it's suddenly a choir of young Irish boys singing. Questions about the Irish boy. I've kept it a mystery until now. That's why I did this stream, for that bombshell. So basically you combine all of these things. It's actually, it's very easy to overload the headroom. And I think when you're trying to make something appear like it's 200% loud and everywhere, but all you have is 100% room, because that's like realistically what you have in a song is you have this much space, but you want it to appear this big. It's all about directing the attention of the listener. It's like, look over here, look over here, look over here. Just from a psychological perspective, that feels like a lot's going on. Doesn't matter if they're all doing things at the same time, but if what you're noticing is very loud over here, and then what you're noticing is very loud over here, it's gonna feel like 200%. And so when you have a cluttered mix like this, that's really important. It's really important. Every time the 808 hits, there's a side chain on everything else, so everything else ducks down, so you're just noticing the 808. You'll hear that. Yeah, even the Irish boy is going, all the attacks are kind of ducked down so that all you notice is the bass. And there's a million examples like that. That's kind of like how we throw a lot into our music. Because that's, I think, a big part of the AJR sound. We want big climaxes. We want to throw big horn sections in. And yet we also want a lot of bass. And we also want the drums to stand out. And obviously Jack's vocal. So the trick is to carve out room for everything.
Believed in God back in 09. Always down to hang, he had no time. Yeah, but in a couple of years, I'll be so out of here. I'll have a lot of new friends and I won't even care. I don't ever think of you. I got to.
Wow, I'm so used to the live version of this. I forgot that we had these effects. So Jack's vocal.
I don't ever think of
you. I need both
you.
Headphones here. Good.
I got too much stuff to do.
We never really do this. I think the last time we did this was in 3:30. We have two lead vocals for Jack panned hard right, hard left. It's a very like Simon and Garfunkel feel. They do that a lot where it's just like I'm right up close in the mic, two different vocals in either ear as opposed to usually the vocal is dead center.
I don't ever think of you.
And then on top of that, we added this guy.
I don't ever think of you.
And that was pitched up using Little Altar Boy, which I like to use a lot. You can kind of pitch things up using Auto-Tune or using X-Form. I like Little Altar Boy because it feels a little bit like there's like a lot of artifacts. It feels a little granular. I could just show you. You can kind
of
play with the formant separately. So formant is how
Alvin and the Chipmunk it is
versus how giant it is and wide the throat is.
I don't ever think of you.
I got too much stuff to do.
And so I think we found a nice midpoint where it doesn't sound too Alvin and the Chipmunk. It kind of sounds emotional because it's like a, it literally sounds like a Little Altar Boy. It sounds like a kid. I think there's something beautiful about that.
I don't ever think of you. Look at all this stuff I do.
And then we have Jack belting over what we just played. Nope. Whoa, what's that?
I don't ever think of you. Look at all this stuff I do.
Jack singing a harmony. Oh, here's the belting.
I don't ever think of you. Look at all this stuff I do. I played shows in Belarus. Now, Joe, do you think I'm cool?
And here's me just doing under that. Yeah, I think if I can figure out how to post this later, I will, I promise.
I could make a joke, but it feels strange. Every time she laughed, it would feel fake. But you could make her laugh in a real way. Yeah, I still use your jokes and they go great. It took a little.
What made us choose Kenny Urban for the beatboxing? A lot of times this just falls into our lap. I think that we don't kind of necessarily seek out collaborators. I just feel like often we ask the question, why not? And so when you think like that, a lot of times whatever song you're working on at that moment, whatever pops up on your TikTok feed or YouTube or whatever, and you see someone talented, you go, why not incorporate them into the song we are working on right now? And that kind of happened with Joe. We had this classical piano. We were looking for just a more hip-hoppy feel to it, to contrast it. And then just a video of Kenny Urban popped up, and we said, this must be some cosmic fate. We have to include it.
I don't ever think of
why do I sing it live? We needed a moment for me in the show, because I think in every tour we have, there's a moment where I sit down at the piano, I do something a little more intimate, like a break. And I think we always felt like Joe had even more emotion, like had even more of an emotional undercurrent than the actual record showed. The record has moments. Laughter would feel. Wait, where? Oh yeah. Too much stuff to do. This stuff is very sincere. It's very emotional. But it's too silly of an idea to take itself so seriously. It's about a kid that I went to high school with that I weirdly never stopped thinking about, never stopped wanting to prove myself to. We thought, okay, that's a relatable idea, but it's not my play. It's not my parents are getting divorced. That's fucking like tragic. This is more, yeah, this is a weird thing that my brain does. And so it didn't feel right to make the song that sappy, that sincere. It felt right to make it a little bit more detached and have this high-pitched vocal and have this Irish boy and beatboxing and take a step back from it and say, I don't know, I'm a little embarrassed, but this is kind of something I want to admit. So we put it out, and then, I don't know, after living with it for a little bit, we realized, oh, there is some deep emotion under this that people are connecting to. How about we do the live version as this very sincere, earnest version? That part is me singing. Is this it? I don't ever think of you. I don't ever think of you. I don't ever think of you. Sometimes we do this. We do this in my play too. And I think Christmas in June also. Where we feel like, okay, we've heard enough, Jack. Now we need an alternate perspective. And often the bridge provides an alternate perspective. Like if you're looking at kind of traditional songwriting structure, the verse, you're starting a story. The chorus, you're wrapping up the song. The verse, you're continuing the story. The chorus, you're wrapping up the song. The bridge is, hey, look at this concept from over here. What about if your parents got divorced? I don't, not that, but like shifting the perspective a little bit. And we find it often helps to have me sing that or have a mystery female come in and sing that. It kind of adds to the, let's look at it from this perspective. And so that's me singing on the bridge. People are asking why I didn't change the name, because Joe's his real name. I don't know, it feels like the more songs I write, the more I get addicted to being honest. It's like, I think for any newer songwriters, you're going to find it's like it's a feeling worth chasing. We started with, Netflix trip. I want to write a song about The Office and how I feel it affected my life. And then as soon as everybody in the crowd goes, The Office affected my life in that way too. It's more than a TV show. It makes you want to edge towards a little more something deep and embarrassing. And so we wrote songs like, No Grass Today, which is like my weird view on marijuana legalization. We wrote songs about moving out, about our parents getting divorced. It's an incredibly addictive feeling if you have that real-time feedback of, we agree with you. And as the crowds grow and everybody goes, we all agree with you. It makes me just want to get more and more personal. It really feels like that. So Joe, I guess except for TMM, stuff that you haven't heard, that gets, I think, more personal than Joe. Up to that point, Joe was definitely the most personal I'd gotten, and I just had this feeling, just this gut feeling like, hey, I gotta not change the name. Changing the name would be disingenuous. Let me use his real name and deal with the consequences later. Oh, that's cool. Some real I got friends all up the coast, proud of all the songs I wrote. But I can't take this backpack off. It comes with me where I go. People are asking about Jack's vocal chain. I could just go through it quickly because I doubt that's interesting to everybody. But we use the compressor that comes with Pro Tools. And I really squash his vocals. Just quickly for anybody that doesn't know what compression is, it's squashing the volume range of vocals. So Jack goes from, maybe I'll put out this up, to right up on the mic like this. That's what compression kind of does. So you could see I'm taking off
maybe I'll put out this
a lot. I'm taking off nearly 10 dB of gain reduction. And that's probably not correct, but it's the kind of thing I just got used to when I was a younger producer. And we all just got used to hearing Jack's voice with a lot of compression, too much crunchy compression. And then it gets to the point where, like, you compress it a little less or you use more expensive compressors. Suddenly it doesn't sound like Jack anymore. It doesn't sound like what our perception of Jack is. So that's compressor. There's the reverb that comes with Pro Tools. There's a transient master that comes with Pro Tools. And that I'm upping the attacks. I'm upping the put out this song, like all the little transient consonants. And then finally, something that doesn't come with Pro Tools, there's an F6 EQ on here.
Maybe I'll put out this song.
And yeah, I like the F6 more than the EQ that comes with Pro Tools. I think I immediately, as soon as I invested a little bit of money and got the F6, I saw a clear difference. The EQ that comes with Pro Tools is a little harsher in like the high mid, like the annoying S's. It feels harsher and it feels like, wow, you put an EQ on that. And the F6, it just feels tonally beautiful and smooth and like, oh, Jack's voice always meant to be, it was always meant to be like that. You didn't put anything on it.
And I won't change your name at all. Maybe then you'll call me up and you'll tell me how cool I got.
And then this part's pretty cool. We put an LFO, or like a tremolator, on the piano to kind of match his beatboxing, because he's beatboxing in these, is that 16th notes? Yeah, 16th notes. So we did a similar thing to the piano, where now there's a tremolator on it. And the volume is quite literally going to add up to and it almost feels like a analog synth arpeggiator or something. That's something that it really excites us. If we can find a synth that is unlike anything we've heard before, cool. I don't know that we ever have, and it's not really where we put our attention. If we can make a piano sound like something you've never heard before, that's really exciting. If we can make a trumpet talk, if we can make a trumpet turn into a violin in the instrumorphing thing, that's really exciting for us. It feels like that's what AJR can bring to the table in the music industry, because the Chainsmokers are better at synths than we are. And we realized that early on, that the stuff in Roses of I honestly wouldn't be able to recreate that, nor should I try, because they already did it. I just don't know enough about building synths and layering sounds. But I know a lot about making an orchestra sound really realistic and how to arrange that properly, or how to make it sound realistic for the 1930s or 40s. That's where I spent all of my time doing research. And that's my favorite kind of music, that kind of old, creepy Disney, Mellow Men, barbershop quartet kind of 40s stuff. That's the music that makes me feel the most. That and Broadway and some hip hop. And so it's like, let's combine all of that, and maybe we'll make something that nobody's ever heard before. Congratulations on 3 million YouTube subscribers. Thank you, guys. That's pretty cool. That's actually really cool. That's our biggest social media, I think. Would we ever collaborate with 21 Pilots? That'd be pretty cool. I think Jack and Tyler Joseph have maybe played Fortnite or about to, or gonna play Fortnite. I never asked Jack about it. I think he asked. Do you play Fortnite? I'm just looking at questions for Joe. Say Crayon Writes. Crayon Writes. I hope I'm not saying anything weird. Or maybe that's just about Harold and the Purple Crayon, the Broadway show. A lot of comments here. Something about synesthesia. Oh, does synesthesia ever play into what you guys decide to use color-wise and vibe-wise for the different album covers? 1,000,000%. We don't start working on the album art until we have a good chunk of the album done, because we'll definitely get a feel for what the vibe is, what the color is. I think with OK Orchestra, we knew it felt very autumn. It felt, well, I guess it felt like a contrast between this autumn, auburn, nostalgic feel and this black and white, dead, wintry feel. Felt very much what, like, The Trick and Adventure Is Out There and Christmas in June, all those are very red and gold and yellow and orange. And then, like, my play, OK Overture, all of those are kind of more black and white. So that felt like the right thing for this album. For TMM, you'll see as we put out more and more art, but it's definitely dark blue black. That's definitely where, like, all of these songs are adding up to feel like that color palette. Let me take like one more question and then I'll go on to DJ's crying for help. AJR question. So I'm really bad at staying focused and I don't know why, but just as a goal, how many hours do you spend actually focusing per day? I always get distracted by Discord and messages. You know what I actually find? I find if I wake up and I go on TikTok, my day is worse. Like, if the first thing I do is go on TikTok or Instagram, how could the rest of my day possibly compete with that amount of stimulation? Like, forget, like, comparing yourselves to others and feeling shitty about yourself. That's real. But, like, just from a scientific, you're seeing everything all at the same time. Then I go to, like, start working or I drink coffee. The coffee doesn't taste as good because I just did 1,000,000 things. My working doesn't give me as much of a feeling because I just saw all my favorite artists doing 1,000,000 things. And so I realized that about myself, and I realized, like, okay, social media is fine, but let me do it, like, once I've accomplished something that day, because then I'll get the full dopamine rush of actually feeling music and enjoying my coffee and enjoying my breakfast. I find that my attention span is better for the day. I think that I suffer from the attention deficit that our whole generation is suffering from, of like, I bet a lot of you are probably like watching this live stream and kind of on TikTok at the same time. It feels really good to focus on one thing for me. If you can fight the urge to want kind of hearing something and seeing something and tasting something and smelling something, like, all at the same time. I know that that sounds good in theory and seems appealing, but what really feels good in the long run is, like, sitting down and watching an entire movie and giving it your all and crying at the end. That's, like, a way more fulfilling experience. I forget what the question even was. Oh, focusing. I think this is something, in school, I wasn't good at focusing. I daydreamed. I couldn't focus on any of the subjects. When I'm working on music, I am unbelievably focused. I think that I found the thing where I can't think about anything else. If I'm working, often I'll just be working for like 8 hours straight. And then I'll look up and I'll be like, I didn't eat breakfast or lunch, and now I should probably eat dinner. Because I'm just so focused. It's all I'm thinking about. It's just immediate, real-time goals. Okay, I know I gotta put in the 808 of Joe, and then I know I gotta put in the stomp, and what am I picturing? Oh, a choir boy. I don't feel good until I've actually sat down and accomplished all that and taken my vision and put it into the music. Therefore, I have no bandwidth to be able to think about anything else. So I think I'm pretty lucky that I found music in that way, but I think everybody must have a thing like that, whether it's exercising or whether it's meditating or swimming or, you know, painting. Everybody must have something where, wow, I just focused on this thing for 8 hours straight. This must be my calling. Hope that was a good answer. Looking at questions here. What's our favorite Broadway show? You know what? I just saw Book of Mormon for the first time and I loved it. I had never seen it before. So funny, and the songs were so catchy, but I think my favorite Broadway show of all time is Wicked, with Les Mis being a close second. Let me take one more question and then I'll jump into the DJ's crying for help. did Joe ever reach out? He did! I'm not gonna tell you anything else about it. Alright, I'm opening the DJ's crying for help. It's a big session, taking a second. Well, this is a interesting question. I'll do my best to answer. Any tips on going through divorce as a teen? God, it's really hard because when you're a kid, your brain is not wired to think about anybody else being happy. It must be like an evolutionary thing or something, but like kids are selfish narcissists. They only care about their own happiness and their own survival. And that's why when you see very little kids, they're just like crying, I want milk and I want this and I want this. And then you grow out of it. And I think that's a big part of growing up. It's realizing I'm not the center of the universe. I'm stupid to think I am the center of the universe. And a lot of times if your parents split up when you're an adult, you have the empathy to say, I want what's best for them and not what's best, what I think is best for me right now. And I think as a teenager, it's actually a little like unfair to your development because you're still a kid. You're still like, I want TikTok. I want to not feel sad in this moment. You're like almost like a caveman. Like your brain isn't fully developed. And my brain still isn't fully developed, you know? And I think if you can get outside yourself a little bit and say, like, what's best for mom and dad? They're not going to be here forever. You know, none of us are going to be here forever. Then what an evolved person. You've skipped, like, 20 years worth of living. If you can get to that point of, forget how I feel right now. What is best for these people that I love? And it's way easier said than done. Because, like, I'm flawed and I often think about, wouldn't it be better if my family was a full thing right now? Then I would be comfortable like I was when I was a kid. Screw what I think. You know, like, I will have my whole life to make the family that I want to make. What's right for mom and dad right now? What do they want? I think that's, I guess, my advice. If you can get outside yourself a little bit and think about that, even just for a second, I think maybe that could really help you. I love how I'm giving advice about families and divorce. I'm not qualified at all for that. Okay, here's DJ's crying for help.
Everyone's laughing at me, but not like they used to.
The room's been... So the DJ's crying for help. Okay, this is the first time I'm breaking into this song, so let's get our hands dirty a little bit. Never talked about this song before. This was a funny one because me and Jack were writing this over the summer, and the first thing we had was that violin and a soft kick drum, and I'll break that open later. But we had that, and then Jack came up with the line, the DJ is crying for help, and then it was this backwards game of, what does that mean? We know that's a cool line. Is it the saddest guy at the party is actually the DJ? That's okay. That's an okay concept for a song. Touched on it a little bit with Humpty Dumpty. You know, the one that seems the happiest is actually the saddest. That's all right. It hit us when we started thinking about ourselves, not making a big commentary on society. Let's think inward. What if the DJ is a metaphor for me, for Jack? And we thought, what about if we write a song about worrying about peaking in college or in your party days, where I see this, I see this with us a little bit, I see this with a lot of my friends, where they had such an identity when they were at parties and when they were drinking and everybody knew them, and that was really their purpose. And we thought, what about if we take this snapshot in time, the way karma takes place in a therapy session? What about if we set the DJ's crying for help in a job interview? and have these, you've wasted your life, but thanks for applying. Have a conversation of like, shit, now I gotta get a job and figure out what my purpose on earth is. That was my purpose on earth. Partying and having fun and being the king of the party back then. We thought that that was something worth writing about and something very real. So the original, I'm so thirsty, hold on, let me just drink. The original pre-chorus was, higher, higher, we can get higher, or can I get higher? We can go hard and never get tired. That was the original pre-chorus. That was back when it was about like party culture. And then it just like hit us. It was a very uncomfortable day of writer's block, but it just hit us. Hired, not higher, higher, hired, hired, can I get hired? Suddenly now it's in the moment. Suddenly now you're in a movie and the scene is a job interview. Okay.
Everyone's laughing at me, but not like they used to.
What really excited us about this song was taking our time. Often with AJR songs, we jump right into, let's show you the coolest thing right away. We thought this song is actually gonna pay off if the first time you hear the coolest part of the song, which is this violin drop, you actually need to like wait and hear the story. It's gonna actually pay off more. We don't usually make that decision, but it felt right with this song.
But not like I'm used to.
Oh, what are the ambient sounds in the beginning? A lot of stuff. It's me. Me going ba da da and then pitching it up sounds ba 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 na na. A lot of reversed vocals. I know there was more stuff. Oh yeah, what's this stuff? Oh, harmony engine but reversed. Singing different chords. And then there's some samples on there. What's this? Oh, that's like a boop, like a pock sound that is reversed and then has reverb on it. Reversed piano. It's like so much stuff that adds up to just ambience. Wait, I think this is something. That's like footage from a trucker radio.
Laughing at me.
Okay.
You've wasted your life, but thanks for applying. Hey, now hold up, we were fun as hell. I'm all grown up, but you couldn't tell. Now I don't know what to do with myself. You got older cause you couldn't.
There's a lot of Alba, Jack's girlfriend, singing on this song. I'll get to it later. I'm really proud of how I was able to treat her vocals.
Now I don't know if there's anything else.
This is the part I want to break down.
The DJ is crying for help.
Okay, here's the coolest stuff. There's a lot of sound effects in here that kind of just paint a picture. And all of this came about when we decided what this song is. This song feels like you're like, you want to run away from your problems almost. And so we thought quite literally, what does that feel like? And so, here it is. There's a lot of stuff here. There's a train whistle that has so much ambient reverb on it. There's galloping horse sounds. And like, again, we could have just used the tom. But what a different vibe that is. That's jungle. This feels like a cowboy riding away. That plus the train whistle. Like, listen to these two things together with more galloping. And it's not that you would hear it right away, but that is more exciting to us, I think, using a train whistle, using gallop, as opposed to using a synth and a tom drum. It just paints more of a picture for us. Okay, what else is under here? There's me singing with harmony engine, making that really sad chord. There's me singing with a lot of reverb. There's a very soft kick drum. This one was interesting because the tendency is to use a kick drum like you would hear in EDM with a lot of attack on it. That's like every EDM song has that kind of kick so that you can hear it in the club and you can hear it on your phone where there's no low end. You always know what the tempo is. I think that is part of the reason why that kick became so synonymous with EDM, because of the technology around it. But we wanted to do the opposite. We wanted this to feel like a sad party. So instead of having this overwhelming attack on the kick, we muffled it completely and it's only low end. Which almost feels like you're outside of the club, right? That's what it would sound like. If you had a closed door here and the club was over there, none of the high end sound waves would be making it through the wall. You would just kind of hear the muffled tone. And so we wanted that feeling. Some strings. And then there's Alba's vocal here. Don't know what to do with myself. So there's a lot of dry vocals. Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. And again, this is Alba, Jack's girlfriend. She sang one sip, one hit in Week. She has a really interesting voice that we keep going back to because she doesn't sound like a trained singer. And I think that's really exciting for us. Anytime we find a really good singer and try to get them to record, it always sounds like, okay, you hired someone else. But Alba's innocence in her voice feels like it's just a continuation of Jack's subconscious. It feels like no extra effort was put into it. Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. So I'll show the layers of recording this, because I'm so proud of this vocal. So there's her regular vocal. Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. Doubled and panned hard right and left. There's this. Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. Two more of her vocals that she recorded that are dead center. This is just a breath track, and we like to do this a lot, where we carve out, you could even see, everything is carved out, below 4K. So it's just the presence of a breath and consonants. And then what's this one? Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. A little bit stronger feeling, belted. And then on top of that is, hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. A similar thing that I put on the Irish boy in Joe. It's this fake choir effect that like automatically detunes all of these vocals to make it sound like a weird alien choir. And then Harmony and Jamore actually played the chords. Okay, so we combine all of those together and we get this. Hey now, hold up, we were fun as hell. I'm all grown up, but you couldn't tell. And then, of course, add a lot of delay and a lot of reverb. And so that, with all of this, it's just swimming around here. Someone said, I thought that voice was computer generated. Exactly our goal. Like, literally, you perfectly described better than I could why we keep recording non-singers. Because singers try really hard, and non-singers are just like, am I doing it right? And that's just such a more endearing sound. Everyone's tripping on pills, but now that... So second verse, we wanted to keep the kick going, and we wanted to have the galloping shum, bum, 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 taken over by a synth. Wait, that's galloping. Wait, but I know there's like a pizzicato string thing. There it is. Just to keep that vibe. And everyone's stacking their bills. So that's a pizzicato violin, like plucked. Bum, 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 bum. And then once in a while, this synth pokes its way through. And I believe I thought I automated the volume. No, maybe not. Yeah, so it's just a constant violin and synth. What the hell is that? Yeah, I fucked up, but I did it my way. Trying, I can start Friday. And on Jack's vocal in the pre-chorus. Hired, can I get hired? Yeah, I fucked up, but I did it my way. Whenever we feel like Jack's vocal sounds a little bit too dry, we always add this harmony engine thing, and it adds all these mysterious notes that we never would have thought of, because the harmony engine is following Jack's voice. He's going 5-3, 5-3, 5-5, 3-5, 3. And so the chord is going 5 chord over what should be a 1 chord. adding in the 7 and the 2. It's like adding in all these weird notes that only a computer would do by accident. Like, we never would have thought to create a harmony stack like that. So that's really exciting for us.
Trying, I can start Friday. Getting a life's a little like dying. Hey, now hold up, we were fun as hell. I'm all grown up, but you
We wanted this part to feel like it built up, right? So the galloping comes in. Not yet the kick, but just the galloping. Shum, ba ba bum, ba ba bum, ba ba bum. And the... There's like a... Yeah, love this. Serves the part of a string. Oh, boom. With it... Yeah, that's like a violin section that has a pitch modulator on it. So, like, instead of going... Bum, instead of going... Bum, 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 it's going... Wow, 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 playing with the pitch each time. So it's like, is that a synth? Is that a violin?
Do with myself. You got older cause you're good at life. I'm all 17 at 35. Now I don't know if there's anything else the DJ is crying for.
Okay, so this end, we wanted it to really feel like it climaxed. We wanted to have so many different parts of Jackie's going, don't leave me, which I don't even remember. I think Jack just ad-libbed that at one point. We said, oh, we gotta throw that in too. And then the entire outro, this thing. The I'm all alone. That is like, let's throw an entirely new thing on in, and while Alba at the same time is singing, hey now hold, crying for help, hey now hold, underneath, and now I'm all alone. We just wanted it to be like, everybody's saying something at the same time, I can't keep track of what's going on, everything's swelling. That part, the and now I'm all alone, came from, we wrote a song called Waiting for the Beat to Drop, that was an early draft of 3 o'clock Things. And the original 3 o'clock Things were those was the old fashioned vocals, those girls saying, come on guys, I promise everything will be all right. Your arms are tired, but keep them up because the beat could drop any day. And so that was Waiting for the Beat to Drop. And the chorus was, and now I'm all alone waiting for the beat to drop. We knew that was special, but it wasn't right for 3 o'clock Things. 3 o'clock Things needed to be a more internal song about politics and about your weird thoughts at night. But we knew that chorus was solid. And so we said, this kind of lines up in a very kismet kind of cosmic way. And so we ended up making this the outro, and we got a lot of gang vocals here.
And now I'm all alone, waiting for the beat to drop. Be kind to me, be kind and wait it out. And now I'm all alone.
This is a perfect example of what I was talking about in the beginning, where you have 100% as your limit. You want the song to sound like 200%. What do? You fill up every space. You make sure wherever somebody's looking is loud and in your face. This is a perfect example. Every time that, and now I'm all alone, anytime there's little pauses in there, Alba comes and pokes back in. Jack goes, don't leave me out. There's no pause here. Or there's echo. I'm all alone, lone, 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 waiting for. There's not a moment for you to register a second of silence.
It's a drop. Be kind to me, be kind and wait out. And now I'm all alone.
Oh my god, everybody's talking at the same time.
Wait till the body starts.
Play Jack's isolated vocals from And Now I'm All Alone. You got it.
And now I'm all alone. Waited for the beat to drop.
Really emotional sounding.
Be kind to me, be kind and wait it out. And now I'm all alone. Waiting till the body starts. Be kind to me, be kind and wait it out.
And now I'm all alone, waiting till the party starts.
We thought, let's end this in kind of a sad way. Not sure we normally do this. The only other example I could think of is the good part where we go, what the hell am I gonna do with mine? That's like a sad ending. Usually AJR ends things in a little bit more of an uplifting way of, hey guys, look at the world on this bright side. And we thought, no, this is kind of appropriate to end with Jack's shaky voice. There's no tuning on it. It's just, till the party starts. And who knows whether it's gonna start ever again. I thought it's like this very melancholy ending that felt right. All right, that's DJ's crying for help. I'll take like a couple questions, maybe. What is getting a life so little like dying mean? Ooh, not sure I wanna tell you. I kinda want you to just interpret that. A lot of questions here, let me pick one. I won't break down. We'll have to do another one of these. I'll be back soon for the I won't break down. And we'll do some other stuff from OKO. If we can get this technology working for this live stream, I love doing this. I get so annoyed when it doesn't work. But if we get into a habit of making this work, I'll definitely be back more. Someone asked, did you add the Jack chord into the song? I forget if I did, if I mentioned that in this live stream or in the last one. But yes, Jack's favorite chord ever is the fourth chord. So like if you're in the key of C, let's say, playing an F and on top of it putting an E. That's his favorite chord ever. And he makes me put it into every single song, whether it's a violin doing it or a harmony or a melody. Yeah, right here. Be kind to me is a perfect example.
Be kind and wait.
Here.
Be kind to me, be kind and wait out. And now I'm all alone, waiting till the party starts.
There, starts is, what key are we in? I think we're in D, so that's a G. And then he adds an F sharp on top. He thinks it's like the saddest chord ever. I agree with him, but I just call it the Jack chord. He thinks it's like the most melancholy chord. So yes, that's in here. What does 17 to 35 mean? Some of these I don't want to explain. Some of these I love hearing your guys' interpretations, and that's that. Here, let me take like one more. What color is this song for you? Purple. What are Jack's thoughts on DJ's Crying for Help? I know he loves it. He actually fought for this to be one that we put out next. He thought it was really important and relatable. He thought it was important to put out one that didn't necessarily sound like single. We wrote this as a huge hook, but instead felt intimate and from the heart and directly to the fans. I think he was just completely right. Just seeing the reaction. I want to thank you guys so much. The DJ's Crying for Help is literally the biggest release we've ever had in terms of streams. Did not expect it at all, but everywhere it went so high on the charts, and we're unbelievably grateful. And I think it's just a cool lesson in, like, you don't have to write something that sounds like a single. Just write something that's real, and it will connect to people. So cool. Truly. We're incredibly grateful. Genuinely. These are great questions. Any more singles before TMM? Yeah, we will definitely put out a few more songs before TMM. Very few people have guessed correctly, TMM. I think maybe I saw one. Why did you decide not to do a big finale beat drop, unlike other songs? For example, Don't Throw My Legos. Well, I mean, I feel like this ending is pretty big. I feel like a lot is going on. Maybe it doesn't feel over the top with a lot of high end. It feels kind of like Coldplay big, like drenched in reverb and ambient. I don't know, it just felt right for the song. I don't want everybody to be going, yeah, the DJ is crying for... I want people to be like, oh my god, I'm overwhelmed, the DJ is crying for help. That felt right. Alright. I think... Oh, come on, there's gotta be one more good question. How many hours went into editing this song? You know what? Not a lot. A lot of hours went into the kind of pre-production stage where we were writing and trying to figure out what the lens that we were seeing this story through was. Was it internal? Was it about the party culture in general? And as soon as we decided it was the job interview, it came really fast. Everything else just kind of made sense. That's how we knew not to do something like the huge beat drop at the end that was psh, 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 because that doesn't feel like a job interview. Job interview is introspective and you're freaking out and thinking about something you just said. Was that wrong? That's what we wanted the song to sound like. All right, guys. Thank you so much. Sorry the beginning was so weird. Hope you enjoyed my advice on being a teenager and having your parents get divorced. And hope you learned something. I'll be back soon. Bye, guys. Thank you.